Fantastic. So to give you a little bit of context, at the origin of this breakout session, there is the recent workshop on web and machine learning that Dom organized in September. And during this workshop, various speakers raised the topic of efficiencies. They raised efficiency issues when they try to process, in particular, media in real time with machine learning, obviously. And so, for instance, Bernard Aboba raised specifically made a reference to the impact of memory copies in web environment. And another speaker, name is Tero Parvianen, I think, from Counterpoint, shared that in one of the experiences that they have been trying, which is around generating music from video frames, the cost of moving the data around is as high as the cost of machine learning inference itself. So actually moving the bytes around takes as much time as doing the actual processing of these bytes, which is not fantastic in practice. So the issue is not restricted to machine learning. So I know that, for instance, the GPU for the Web Working Group has been discussing the impact of copies in the context of how to use the content of the canvas or video element as a GPU texture last week. There's been an extensive discussion about that. More importantly, that seems to be the kind of issue that spans multiple groups and that as a result may not have a clear owner. So we thought, Dom and I thought, that it could be useful to convene people here from different perspectives to discuss. And that's exactly why we're here. So I would like to take 10 to 15 minutes to introduce the situation as I understand it. And since we're recording the talk, I'll go through it, and perhaps it's better if you keep the questions for later, or as Dom was saying, you can chime in, but remember that you're going to be recorded. And then the goal is to discuss. What I think would be useful, a useful outcome for this breakout session, is to clarify whether things are under control already, meaning that people are actually discussing and each group is doing what it should be doing, and there's no reason to worry about memory copies in general, or whether actually there is a need to worry about memory copies in general, and we should be looking for some kind of coordination effort somewhere, somehow, with some people to make sure that things are being handled correctly. So to try to reason about this, I thought I would try to represent the memory, and the different components that may trigger a memory copy, but that may explain why we do memory copies. So this visualization is going to be extremely rough, incomplete, and even possibly wrong, but that's okay, it's to trigger discussion. So that's fine if it's not the right way to think about it. So anyway, this first block was the memory. This block is actually divided into two. There is the CPU memory and the GPU memory. On most systems, they are physically distinct. I mean, if you need to process a CPU-based buffer with the GPU, you will have to upload the buffer first to the GPU memory before you can process it with the GPU, and vice versa, obviously. And then I try to represent the browser in there. The browser needs to deal both with the CPU memory and the GPU memory. And it has actually to manage different internal isolated runtimes. I don't know if runtime is the right term for what I wanted to represent, so I used land here. So in the browser, you're going to have the JavaScript land, you have the WebAssembly land, and you'll have the WebGL and WebGPU land. The JavaScript land and the WebAssembly land are tied to the CPU memory. The WebGL and WebGPU land is tied to the GPU memory. If going down a bit further, the JavaScript land is actually divided into further regions, thanks to workers. And browsers leverage the available hardware to provide inputs, outputs, and run specific processing algorithms. That's what appears on the right of this diagram there. So for I/O, we're talking about network cards, we're talking about microphones, cameras, speakers, and screens. For processing, we're talking about media encoders and decoders, which are often hardware-based, especially on embedded devices. And it seems to me that I didn't exactly know where to draw these hardware boxes. It seems to me that at least theoretically, it's doable to tie them to either the CPU memory or the GPU memory, but I'm happy to be wrong, or I guess, I mean, feel free to correct me. So all of these blocks need to communicate with the browser acting as mediator. So in a non-optimized version of a browser, memory copies are going to happen whenever one of these boundaries get crossed. And when some, for instance, when some JavaScript code needs to exchange with a WebAssembly module, then a copy is going to be made. When some I/O gets processed by the browser and handed over to the JavaScript, then a copy needs to be made. But that's in a non-optimized version. So if I now use that as a way to reason about memory copies, I think that the main reason why memory copies are needed are the ones that appear on this slide. There are the transfer across memory boundaries, we just saw that, and some of them are physical, so that means there's no way that we can remove them. So that's the transfer between CPU memory and GPU memory. And others are more artificial, but isolation may be needed, for instance, for security reasons. Copies can also be triggered by the need to transcode internal structures. So that may be the case between JavaScript and WebAssembly, for instance. A buffer doesn't look the same in a JavaScript environment and in a WebAssembly environment. Or you may need to, browsers may need to transcode, for instance, a decoded video frame that is in RGBA into a YUV or vice versa. So more generically, there is often a need to process streams, to decode them, to encode them, to decrypt, to encrypt. And these operations are likely to trigger copies that are probably unavoidable. There may be other reasons why copies are made. One, I think that has happened at least in the past or that still continue to be done this way is you probably want in some APIs to have a guarantee that whenever the application hands over a buffer to an API function, then this API function and the taking for granted that this API function is going to do the work asynchronously, this API function is going to start by making a copy of the bytes so that if the app changes the buffer just after the call, then it doesn't affect the outcome of the API function. So it provides some guarantee as to what's going to happen. And that probably, that may explain why some copies are made too. And perhaps it's more generally, it's actually easier for developers to just have APIs that actually require somehow memory copies because they're going to be easier to use. Or, of course, last reason is that it may be the cost of copies may seem negligible, and there may be good reasons to do copies because it's easier to implement, for instance. And in that case, that may be just an implementation issue, and there's probably not much that we can do, we need to do from a specification perspective. So if I now look at reducing what it would take to reduce memory copies, looking back at my fantastic diagram, that means getting direct communication lines across boundaries for me. So for instance, in a media processing scenario, if media decoding is going to take place in the GPU memory, then perhaps the ideal processing pipeline would be to do everything on the GPU from the initial fetch to the final rendering to the screen. So again, some copies cannot be avoided. So for instance, here between the WebAssembly land and WebGPU land, you cannot expect not to have copies if the bytes actually have to go from the CPU memory to the GPU memory or vice versa. But you may hope to have some reference, for instance, to the different buffers. And in practice, there are already mechanisms in place to get these direct communication lines. Shared array buffer is an example. Transferable interfaces is another one. And of course, there are plenty of ad hoc opaque interfaces that have been designed especially to deal with streams. And they've been designed as opaque on purpose so that they don't expose the bytes. And this allows browsers to optimize memory handling. So that's true for media stream track. That's true for streams, the media element, nodes in the web audio API. And I believe that there is an ongoing plan to expose opaque frames in web codecs, opaque decoded frames in web codecs for the ones that are GPU backed. GPU web codecs folks might want to chime in there at some point, maybe after the talk. I thought it would be useful. I don't know if Bernard has arrived. I thought it would be okay, wonderful. It might be useful to quantify the what gains we might expect from reducing memory copies. And Bernard has been working on a few scenarios there that would shed some light on this. So Bernard, if you want to introduce the use case, the floor is yours.
This use case is conferencing gallery view, which has become a popular video conferencing features, particularly in education, where the teacher may want to keep an eye on each student in the class. With a K-12 class often exceeding 25 students and college classes supporting much larger class sizes, there's been a demand for larger and larger galleries. Today, native applications such as Zoom and Teams are offering 7x7 gallery views, but I believe that web applications are currently limited to about 4x4. In this scenario, the teacher typically only sends one or maybe two streams if they're doing both video and screen share, but they receive many streams. The use case is well within the capabilities of today's cable internet services. It can be done typically for less than 30 megabits, but it pushes the boundaries in the receive decode to display path due to the large volume of raw video that needs to be displayed. So we implemented this natively with a zero copy all GPU pipeline. So on receive, the data will go directly from the network interface to the GPU. The decode is done in the GPU, and then you go from the GPU directly to rasterization. And if you do all of that, then you can get a 7x7 gallery at 30 frames per second, with the resolution depending on the device. But if you do each additional copy in the receive pipeline, because that is the bottleneck, will reduce the maximum gallery size. So if you have one additional copy, that will reduce the maximum gallery size to 5x5. If you have two copies, it'll go to 4x4, which is where web applications are today. And if you have three copies, which is what we have in current web transport implementations, that would be one copy just purely on the receive. That probably will go to zero copy over time, but then there's another one for process separation, and then there's another copy for rasterization. Then you will be limited to 3x3. So this is a use case that, because the memory operation is the bottleneck, it directly translates each copy, reduces performance directly. So I'd also add that there's no machine learning going on here on the receive path. That occurs only on the send path. So for example, if you're doing a background blur or custom backgrounds or anything like that, that happens on the send side. So it isn't really a consideration here. So that's this use case for gallery view.
Thanks a lot, Bernard. So I think that's really illustrative of a need, a practical need and practical impact of memory copies there. And again, the fact that it's not a machine learning issue in this case, nothing related to machine learning, it's broader than that. So if we, I've been looking around, I've seen various proposals that are under discussions in various groups. which are directly or indirectly related to reducing memory copies. The ones that are listed there are the ones that crossed my radar. The touch on stream, web transport, WebAssembly, WebGPU, web codecs, and media in general, WebRTC, of course. Some of them got started a long time ago, and so it may be useful to review their status after I'm done. There may be other additional IDs that may be worth discussing, and I have no idea whether they've already been discussed, whether there are bad IDs, or whether they should be discussed. So for instance, the ability to fetch directly into the GPU memory may be already possible, I don't know. Or the ability for an application to be explicit about the media, the processing pipeline that it's going to follow. If you know that you what are the different processing steps that you're going to do on your on a media stream, perhaps if you could tell that in advance to the user agent, there may be a way to optimize things. I don't know, or maybe not. So that's it essentially for the presentation. I believe it would be useful to look at possible scenarios, such as the one that Bernard presented, understand how many boundaries in my diagram these scenarios actually cross, and ask ourselves the question, are these scenarios being addressed somewhere? Is there a group that actually tracks them? For instance, it may be that most interesting scenarios only cross one boundary and already have a clear owner and are being addressed through one-to-one exchanges between two groups. And if that's the case, then maybe this breakout is a much ado about nothing and we can just go back to work. Or it may be also that most of the problems are implementation specific. So maybe there's nothing that we should be working on at the specification level. Or perhaps there is a need for more coordination. And given the participation here, I suppose that at least there seems to suggest that there is some need. So the question becomes, how do we do it? So let's discuss. I think we can stop the recording now and start the discussion.